residents. Presumably at that stage, those residents have raised concerns with you about the trees and about the traffic issues. And yet from what the presentation you've both given, you haven't addressed the concerns that you've heard again tonight from residents. And I'm just wondering, were those concerns not on your radar? Or what happened when they said to you, we were concerned about traffic speed on Highfield South, we're concerned about the lack of trees and replacement. You said you're not able to answer the question tonight, but presumably it would have been asked of you previously in your consultations. I'm just wondering at what stage you will be dealing with those issues, or do you not intend to deal with those issues?
Yeah, yeah. Well, sir.
We did understand, we had our engineer and Stuart, traffic assessment, which you submitted to planners.
Between the two accesses, it seems to be acceptable to them. There's no material issues that have been raised that would undermine the highways officer's advice today.
Okay, I don't want to labour the point, but you've gone through a consultation exercise with the purpose of listening to residents. The residents, as we've heard again tonight, have raised two very specific issues over tree planting and the highways issues. And what you're saying is you're just going to ignore those because the highways officer has said something different. So I would question the value of the consultation that you carry out because you don't appear to have addressed the concerns that you've heard again tonight from the objectors.
Yes,
sir. Just
a point of that were carried out and how the design was amended, picking up some of the comments that were made along that way. So just to summarise, we have taken on board the comments that were raised and where best possible we made changes to the design layout reflective of those comments. We carried out additional tree surveys, listening to the concerns of the retention of the forest or the woodland area, and we also appointed a landscape designer as well to ensure that any proposals going forward were enhancing the existing trees, the existing woodland, and the character of the site, and how that sat within the new development, and I guess how the scheme knitted in with those existing features as well. Originally, we had extra care being accessed off Ravenswood, which was a concern in one of the consultations, so then we revisited the access points into the site, which meant that we changed the access for the extra care of Highfield South, which meant actually less through traffic was going through the site, so the parking is close to the entrance, so it reduces the amount of traffic going through the site, so the residential areas are mainly traffic for those houses rather than any through routes. The roads themselves don't connect, and that's intentional design feature to avoid any through routes and speeding. So there's, I think, approximately 30, 35 properties to access off Ravenswood Avenue, and the others from Highfield South. We did listen to the comments. We had, I think it was three public consultations, and we tried to express during those sessions how the design was being developed, and we did our best to try and take on board the comments raised and incorporate those within.
I mean, obviously, I'm aware of Taurus as a housing association and obviously a community based organisation in the Wilsons region. Touching on what Ian sort of commented on, the highways engineers have given their professional opinion and said there's no impact. Yet you've heard concerns of the residents. My question to the professional highways officer will be in the other part of the committee. But given that residents have raised concerns, would you or have you not considered entering into a voluntary arrangement for things such as traffic calming in the local area, rather than it be a heavy-handed Section 106, which I believe would have to be justified by the traffic figures, would you not consider that as a way forward for to meet some of the residents' concern? And secondly, the issue of trees can be mitigated or negated by using other organisations to plant trees, maybe not directly on the site, but certainly the perimeter of the site or the field arranging a donation to a local organisation that will plant more trees and enhance the environmental issue. So it seems to me that you've been pointed in the right direction by the residents, but you've not shown that extra, gone that extra mile to do that. If that was something that you might consider. I have to say, we very rarely get an application that is perfect in the eyes of every resident. No application is, but it seems to me it could have gone a little bit further down the route of what the residents concerned Claire, to get to this point. So, in a question, would you consider going into some sort of arrangement with the highways, local highways, and obviously get some extra trees in and around the area?
For highways, obviously that'd be a section 278 works, which we'd have to enter into. Obviously, we've got an extra care scheme there, and we said during the consultation, if the traffic is that bad, there'd be something we'd have to look at too, because we've been having a lot of people crossing the road, going in that locality on buggies, getting the comments we made about the amount of cars, but car take up for the residents in extra care is very low. We're providing a buggy store, buggy chairs and buns. So obviously we've been having our elderly residents going on Highfield South and accessing the site. So we obviously if there's some traffic calming proposed, then it's something we'll look into.
Final question. Obviously all these schemes have to have a financial tie-up, they have to weigh financially. You talk about imminent grants. What sort of in your financial planning, what sort of expense are you expecting to have to spend on Ravenswood to get up to the standard?
Ravenswood, the most I can there, I don't know if you've actually been in there, but it is, I was in there a couple of months ago, and it is in a very sorry state. There's contaminated water in the basins, there's dry rot everywhere, water pouring down the staircase. We're looking around probably about touching on £1 million, £900 to £1 million to restore.
Thanks. Thank you, Chair. I mean, not wishing to repeat really what Councillor Lewis and Councillor Foulkes has said, but you get the feeling sitting here as a member of the council having to make a decision on this that really, the residents have not been difficult with this. They've accepted that something has to be done on that site. And they've shown that willingness to work towards the developers. However, you do get the feeling that this is now being done to them, basically, not done with them. I know Highfield really well, and I don't know if you've been down there in the daytime, but particularly, I think one of the residents mentioned, when the schools are going in and coming out, it is an absolute nightmare down there. It really is. I mean, and I don't wish to sound disparaging, but people use it as a rat run. I've done it myself because you come from Rock Lane West and you go to go down Dacre Hill and you think, well, this is a nightmare. So you tend to go up Highfield South, only to be met with that small little road right at the bottom where it meets onto Rochester Road, and then you've got St John's coming out and you've got St John's Kessington coming out. It's an absolute nightmare because people tend to even avoid the main road coming out of the Tesco supermarket going towards the Oval. You tend to avoid that during certain hours of the day, and I just think that more has to be done, particularly with the residents, because it's a well-established area there. They're properties of many years, well looked after, and already they suffer from this that road being used. And it just seems totally unfair when residents have been in consultation with a previous Member of Parliament and councillors, but it looks as if their words have just fallen on deaf ears, basically. And the evidence that yourselves are putting forward, I just wonder, have you seen it in daylight hours? Have you observed it? Have you taken time to go down there? Because, cause clearly, if you have, you must be going down there at a time of day that nobody else is, because it is a nightmare, and clearly something's policy all along to work with you, and it just doesn't seem acceptable to me.
If you just respond to that, I think it would be really useful to hear from the Highways Officer in terms of informative two.
Yes, we will certainly be bringing
these options, such as traffic regulation orders, are open to the council.
I appreciate that as the applicant, you presented evidence of traffic movements. After we finish this stage meeting, we'll be bringing our officers in to speak about traffic issues. If the answer to the question is, I refer the member to the answer I gave some moments ago, that is perfectly legitimate for you, and there are some aspects of the question that are better tackled by IMG. I appreciate that. Are there any further? Thank you very much for your presentation. Having heard that, I was comfortable then to hear directly from Highways and maybe to explore some of those issues.
Thank you, through you, Chair. The highway impacts of the traffic predicted to be generated by proposed developments have been properly assessed at key junctions on the road network. Those impacts have been demonstrated to be immaterial and are far from being able to be categorised as severe. Therefore, no highway capacity mitigation measures are proposed in order to make the development proposals acceptable in planning terms. It should also be noted, as I think was mentioned earlier, that the former use of the site as a large school is likely to have generated similar or more levels of traffic when it was in operation. With regards to providing sort of speed reduction measures on Highfield South, we are aware of requests that have been made in the past. However, the road safety records that we have before us, which are provided to the council by the police, show that over the last 5 years there have been no injury-related collisions along Highfield South, and therefore the existing accident record does not represent a material concern in the context of the development. Highfield South itself has a long-term excellent collision history. In terms of parking, the parking associated with the houses is to be provided on driveways adjacent to dwellings. Each dwelling has a minimum of two spaces per dwelling. The apartments include 8 spaces in a separate provision. The extra care facility is to include 52 parking spaces, of which 5 will be accessible bays, as well as designated drop-off area adjacent to the main entrance. And you know, we feel that this level of parking is viewed as sufficient given the proximity of public transport links in the area. There are high frequency services which operate on Old Chester Road to the west of the site, which is approximately 400 metres walk from that site. And there's also the Rock Ferry rail facilities, which are located to the north of the site as well.
Okay, very interesting application with a long history. I think there's something we have to consider. Although one of the major concerns is about the environmental issues about the trees, and then on the other hand, we're saying we want more car parking. The two sort of lack a little bit at each other in covering the vehicles and asking for more trees. I think the trees issue is something that the council can do, and the tree strategy is something that can amend or do something about that. Extra care facilities are required. We have an ageing population on the world, but when we like it or not, there is and will be a demand for those sort of things. I would have preferred to see in section 106 with some benefits for the local community around traffic calming. I feel for ourselves seems to be the pinch point, whether that would have been. Having said that, I guess if the action levels and the professional opinion is such that it would be unreasonable to demand a section 106, so we're there to develop it again, post whatever decision is made tonight to re-engage with residents and try and come up with something. The thing that's overriding my opinion on this first person to touch on it was the highways officer. It was the previous, what it was previously. It was at one point in its life, a flush in secondary school. The traffic movements associated with that dwarfed by far any associated with a residential development. I think the way residential development's been designed, it encourages people to who go there are people with an interest in their sort of residence and so on. It's not sort of, I don't think it's adding to the nature, but the traffic movements created by those individuals have been professionally assessed and looked at. And then we go back to where we've been a number of times with where we're going with our policy. We've had a number of applications on former school sites and have been generally regarded as brownfield and windfall sites that have come available. We've had a big one in Bromborough, who we are recently, former school, with more houses on it than this particular site being allocated. So I'm finding it difficult for us to be able to go into bat in terms of an appeal, given where we're going as a council, given where the government policy is going with housing, given where the demands for these types of housing. It is quite an interesting mixed development with a bit of everything, if you like.
No social housing. No.
And there is social housing, I believe, on the site, and Torres are a social housing provider. We are not, again, we're not the dictator of what social housing, what the only planning guidelines we can apply to is those around the affordable housing policy. We've said this before. So it's, I'm trying to think of what if we were to go against this in an appeal with all sort of things, if all sort of things that are being talked about at the moment, says local plan, protection of green belts, and this site coming forward, where would we pitch our point of reason for refusal? My view is that there isn't a it would be a very difficult, defendable reason for refusal if anyone was to come up with one. So I understand, I think the other thing that I think needs to be stressed, we've also seen developments before where precious buildings have absorbed a lot of money from the site. I can think of one on the perimeter of Beckenham Park, which we did recently, although it wasn't listed, Evan Dillery's house. We went through a torturous debate on that, and is now up to scratch and was converted to apartments. So, converting to apartments is a way of saving the list of buildings. And you've heard a ballpark figure of £1 million at least to be able to do that. So that again means the constraints of the site need to take, no developer develops without a long-term return. And I can assure you, most housing associations work on a very long-term return, something like 30 to 40 years return over that budget. So it's not, I think we'd be losing more by refusal than we gain by approval. And that's my honest opinion. You don't come not planning to be popular, come here to give your opinion. And that's where I am at the moment, but I always remain to the very last minute open to persuasion about a reasonable, defendable reason for refusal.
Steve, I was agreeing with Steve up to a certain point in there, as usual, we're not going to tangent to the vote. It's either for or against you, we're either against the proposal, we didn't throw it all out. I think the points that Steve made in the previous part of this discussion with the applicant, I think that could have been explored more prior to coming to the committee tonight. And I think he made the point, Steve made the point, that this is a social housing provider. If this was a multi-million pound private developer who was simply going to come in, build the development, and then naff off and leave the council to pick up the pieces, I think it would be the same argument. I'm disappointed that a social housing provider has not taken on board the concerns of the residents that we've heard tonight. It's not beyond the wit of a social housing provider to listen to the people that they're supposed to be serving, which is the wider community, and have come up with a scheme that they could say for definite it was going to be a like-for-like replacement on the trees, which would have answered one of the points, and not saplings, but decent-sized trees, that would have dealt with one aspect of the concern. The other one is the speeding issue and the traffic issue on Highfield South. I accept what the Highways Office has said, but frequently we've had 106 agreements where we have entered into those agreements with the developer because they improve the situation, regardless of what the data is telling us. So I can point to developments where we've agreed to, for traffic calming, even though the accident record has been very low, but we accept that the traffic volumes on the road justify a 106 agreement. So I don't think either of those points, while I accept what Steve said, and I think even the residents who are here today said they're not opposed to the development, but they have concerns about these two aspects in particular. And I would like to know from you, Cllr, and the officers sat by you, in terms of what conditions we can place on this application, if it's approved, that would meet the needs for a like-for-like, at least on tree replacement, and some traffic calming measures on Highfield South. What are the grounds that we can do that with the developer? The developers have, as far as I'm concerned, the developers have the opportunity to enter into this in a voluntary way. They fail to do that, instead of relying on what the Highways Office has said, which is fine, but I think as a social housing provider, I want to see a commitment to this community over the 30 or 40 years that Steve has outlined.
It's not, with respect to the it is not helpful, while we're attempting to listen to what members and officers are saying, to have interruptions. I gave, unusually, you can go back through the video record, I allowed 15 minutes for objectors. Previous years, all three petitions were about 5 minutes between them. So I feel I've given adequate and plenty of opportunity for the case to be made at the right part of the meeting, and it's not helpful for the meeting to be interrupted by heckling from the floor. Okay, hopefully I won't have to underline that again. So I'll now ask.
Through you, Chair. If I deal with the issue of the trees first, then. So the application is supported with a tree survey that has been comprehensively looked at by our own tree officer. There are a number of trees on site that differ in terms of age and their importance in terms of their longevity in terms of their lifespan moving forward. So it's probably difficult to see on that plan, but there's a line that runs through here that shows the existing bank of trees. So this area here does involve removal of some trees within that area. But the tree officer has assessed those trees to be removed, and he's quite happy that the ones that are being taken out and the thinning that will take place will secure the long-term future of those trees that are to be retained within this area. The shaded area within the lighter shaded trees within the development are new trees that are proposed to be planted. There is a landscaping scheme that is conditioned to be approved as well. So there is significant retention of trees, particularly around the perimeter of the site, but there is also the scope and the intent to plant new trees within the new development that we as planning officers are happy with, and that our own tree officer is content with as well, having regards to the development. In terms of the highways impacts, we've heard from Carl, the engineer, around the issues that have been looked at and supported by a transport assessment. And any Section 106 agreement must be properly related to the development that is proposed. So I'm sure Cecilia will support me in this when I say that it wouldn't be reasonable to attach a Section 106 agreement to something asking for measures that are not deemed to be necessary to make the development acceptable. And we would lose that appeal. It just wouldn't stand up. So Carl has set out quite clearly, I think, for members, the highways implication of the development. We've heard that the previous use of the site as a school would have resulted in significantly higher levels of traffic movement around the site than what is proposed from this. So I think on balance, as I said at the beginning when I did my presentation, we feel that the application has been developed as far as it can in terms of moving it forward and recommending something that is approvable.
Trees have been put to us.
with the layout plan that there is compensatory planning highlighted by the lighter coloured green on the layout plan. It seems to me, looking at that, there appears to be more than 11 pieces of green infrastructure, to use the parlance, than the 11 that's being lost. I think I'm satisfied in my own mind that the quantum, that was the question I asked, of loss is that there will probably be more green infrastructure on the site than is currently that is likely to be lost by course of development. A second issue that was put to us was around the issue of footpaths and routes through by pedestrians from Ravenswood to Highbury. I had noted on the plans to the left as one exits existing Ravenswood into the extension. There is what's described on the plan as defensive plan, which removes the shortcut route from Ravenswood through to Highbury. It strikes me that the routes through from Ravenswood to Highbury would therefore be tortuous. You'd have to go through the wooded area, or you'd have to come right to the end of the extension and then through and down. It strikes me in those circumstances that the idea that there will be opportunity, because the issue is one of security. So if there are issues of security at the far end of Ravenswood, it would be easier, if you like, to leave Ravenswood by the entrance of Ravenswood rather than attempt to circumnavigate the site to exit by Highbury Avenue. The key matter clearly before us, was mentioned in all three presentations of objection, was that of traffic and members of raised concerns. Highfield Road is a incredibly straight road, so it comes as no surprise that the residents raise issues of speed. It's clearly a present problem in that road. And therein is the rub. We're not the Highway Authority, this is the Planning Committee. The problem is an existing one. It's not a problem that will manifest itself as a result of the development. The point being made about increasing congestion, etc., is a well-founded one. However, it's not an unusual one. Up and down the country, residents will be complaining about large developments and the traffic that is produced by it. And as it's an ongoing national issue, national planning policy is clear on the matter. A quote from the National Planning Policy Framework. Development should only be prevented or refused on transport grounds where the residual cumulative impact of development are severe. Now, the developers put in front of us their own transport assessments, which are based on that national modelling. These have been assessed by our own engineers. And the hurdle, if you like, of severe is not triggered in my mind, and there's certainly appealing case law that will back that up. So whilst we may be sympathetic to the existing problem, the advent of a new development on the site does not mean that problem will be more severe than perhaps it already is, and that is the balance that we will have to make on that one. Given what I've said there, I've listed sort of pros and cons, and in my mind the planning balance shifts to approval. Any members have any comments after that, in which case, from the chair, then I'll move approval. Is that seconded?
I'll second the chair, as I've spoken in favour of it.
Can I see members in favour of the development? And those against? Members of the public, the application has been passed by 8 votes for 1 abstention. That was the substantive application. We now move to the Mr. Building Concerns application. I don't think we need further debate on that. I'll move that for approval from the chair. Is that seconded?
I'll agree to second that, Chair. Can I see those
in favour?
No,
that means that,
sorry.
This is the listed building concerns.
So, planning permission is sought for the demolition of the existing clubhouse and the erection of 14 residential units. The development proposed comprises of a terrace of 8 two-bedroom houses together with 6 apartments within 3 blocks. The apartment blocks have been designed to reflect the two-storey housing on the site and externally read as two-storey dwellings. The development would secure the provision of 100% affordable housing, which would help improve the overall housing offer in this area. The proposals would mean the loss of a bowling green. However, the Royal British Legion Club that operated the site has closed, and the green has not been used since its closure. There are 13 greens within the wider locality, which is considered sufficient to serve current and future demand, and therefore the loss of this green is not considered to be detrimental to playing fields provision when weighed against the provision of 100% of affordable housing on this site. There is a mix of house types within the immediate area, including terraced housing. It is not considered that the proposals would detrimentally impact on the amenities of adjoining properties. The design and scale of the proposed development is considered to be appropriate. Proposals are considered to provide for additional housing in the area, contributing toward the borough's housing stock and providing 100% affordable housing, which improves the overall offer in this area. The application is recommended for approval, subject to a Section 106 agreement to secure the affordable housing provision. There is no qualifying petition.
Okay, so that's about the application that's been removed from delegation by a ward councillor. I'd like to see in the open to members then.
Can you just ask a question, please, Chair? As far as planning regulations are concerned, do bowling greens count as playing fields?
Yes.
Yes.
Any other contributions? No. In the absence of argument, then, maybe from the chair, I'll move approval. Is that seconded?